Hello, it's Keith here, and this is the second episode of my Grime Z80 videos. This is the second day I've been working on the project, and I wanted to show you the current state of the code. So you can see three of the versions here, and you'll see things have progressed quite a bit. Let's have a look at the Amstrad CPC version first, but the functionality is basically the same on all of them. So you can see in the corner I've got this FFFF, and that is the state of the keyboard and joystick, just being displayed on screen for testing. And you can see I've got a single tile now being drawn on the screen. Now the colours are wrong on the Amstrad CPC version still, but that's just a Sprite export problem. That's not an issue I'm particularly worried about. But I'm now holding the joypad, and if I move the cursors around, move the buttons on the joypad, you'll see I'm now trailing a series of blobs. And if I get to the end of the screen, I can't go off the screen. And so in the next version of the game, this will become the player's sprite. As well as that, if I press the first fire button, you can hear there's a beep. And if I press the second fire button, you'll see the screen actually clears. So we've kind of made the world's worst drawing package here. Now if I just close the Amstrad version here, and we'll have a look, you'll see that the functionality is the same on all of the systems. The beep is different because the pictures aren't matched. The reason I've been able to get the sound working so quickly is I actually, before I started working on this project, I'd written some code for a driver which is called, I've called it Chibi Sound, which is a simple sound system. And all you do is you give it a single byte from 0 to 255, and it has 64 different pitches. It can add and or remove noise, and it has two possum volume levels. So it gives the ability for simple beeping. The important thing about it is I've written the same function on all of the systems I'm going to be using, with the exception of the TI 83, which I don't believe can make any sound at all. So I can clear, there's something wrong with the clear screen on that. I need to check that out, obviously. But almost working then, maybe. So here's the Game Gear version, and as you can see, very much the same functionality, and the pitch is very high on the beep, but it is beeping, and the clear screen does work on this. It's just the Game Boy version. There's obviously something wrong with the tile redraw code. It must be misunderstanding the height of the screen. Anyway, we can have a look at that. Let's just check the Sam Coupe Probert version. This is working now. There were problems with it before, but it was just the I was forgetting to use the screen start drawing command, so the ROM was actually covering up half the screen, so I was trying to write to the screen and nothing was happening. But you can see it works the same. You got your beep, and if I press the enter key, which is the second fire, you can see the screen clears. So again, it's all of the code that's doing the logic is the same for all the systems, so as long as there's no bugs in the drivers that do the graphics, everything works fine. Now, there is one problem I'm a little bit worried about that might come up later in the week. Let's have a look at the MSX1 version. Now, here it is, and it all looks pretty good. And I draw the... Oh, that was unexpected. I don't know why that's suddenly glitched in. Very strange. I'll have to look at that. I don't know why that's happening. Never didn't see that earlier today, but anyway, the thing that's concerning me is when I clear the screen, apart from that strange glitch, it's quite slow, much slower than the other systems. The reason for this is the MSX and the MSX2, the screen display is not easily accessible in a bitmap format, which I'm trying to trick the MSX 1 and 2 into emulating a screen like the Amstrad CPC. And it can't really do it, so there's a lot of extra commands being put in to do that emulation, and with such a big high color screen, you see the MSX2 is even slower. It's very slow redrawing, and the problem with that is if you look at the Grime game, when the mold grows and all of the seeking parts come out, that's a very big screen update, and so I'm not sure how fast the game's going to be, if it's going to be fast enough. And what I may have to do is I may have to write a special driver that doesn't use my bitmap code for the MSX 1 and 2 to go overcome that. But for now, I don't want to waste time on that because I want to get the game playable before I start working on specialist stuff like that. If the MSX version's super slow and I run out of time, so be it. If I get the game playable and working and I've still got some time, I'll make some new MSX drivers that will be more efficient. But anyway, so that's the state of that one. I think that's really... all of them, so they all, as designed, they all work the same. Now, so I did come across some bugs today. The first one, as I said, the start drawing, stop drawing, but that was actually within the code for this. I did find some bugs in sort of general tutorials-based code. There was a mistake in the 256 wide table definition on the Amstrad CPC. I'd forgotten to use an align command, so it was reading one of the lines wrong and corrupting the screen, which was quite difficult, but I've fixed that now. Another problem I came across, so there was a bug in the TI-83 code. When you got to the bottom line, it was trying to do another next line command, and that was sending the command C0. C0 is actually a completely different command on the system, and it sets the contrast, and for whatever reason, it was turning the background of the screen below. I don't know quite whether that's supposed to be a backlight emulated or something, but it certainly wasn't what it was supposed to be. And God forbid you carried on writing below that and everything went crazy. So I've had to put in this extra thing here just that checks the current status of C. And if it goes over C0, then it doesn't do any more line changes. And that fixes that problem. But nothing major there. I've also made a change on the tie to remove the waiting. There's usually an animated icon in the corner, but that was not appropriate. But most of the coding work I've done today on the TIE version, and in general, to be honest, is to allow, I don't know if you noticed, the game is now using a much smaller screen size. So where, as I said yesterday, whereas all of the tiles on the other systems are 8x8, on the TIE it's actually 4x4. Well, how have I done this? Well, it's taken a few things. Firstly, I've done some coding changes to my sprite editor. Now, the sprite editor, which you can see here, has always had viewing options here in the settings here, which allow you to show it in different color depths. But the export routines were actually separate in the past. So that while the export routines would, for the CPC, mimic the color representation, they now are actually using, it's actually sort of using the same bridging mechanism to convert the colors, so the exporter and the viewer are using the exact same color conversion routines, and this gives me some options with regards to how to deal with colors over color 4. So colors 4 and above on the 4 color mode, there has to be some kind of conversion, and one option would be to cycle back, so color 4 becomes color 1, color 5 becomes color 2, color 6 becomes color 3. But I've actually done it in pairs here, so 4 and 5 would become 1 and 2, 6 and 7 would become 1 and 2, 8 and 9 becomes 1 and 2. So now I can have two options to do that, but I've also created this rather odd option, which is this quarter res option, and if I do a refresh there, you'll see all of the sprites now scale to a quarter of their size. So I can, and it's also in TI-83 two color mode. So this is a good way for me to very quickly convert my sprites. And at the moment it's just for testing. And to be honest, I probably wouldn't use that when I'm doing the final version. But for now, it gives me a good way of scaling down the sprites very quickly. So I've got testing sprites without having to maintain multiple versions of the sprites. And later on, I may add versions of the Spectrum one, which have dithering for the different brightnesses and things. So this is going to give me a lot more flexibility now that I've got this sort of common view and export convert color conversion routine programmed in. And to be honest, I should have done that in the first place, but didn't think about it when I started this program. So I've mentioned before, the sprite editor has always been being upgraded as the requirement came in place. I really don't have time to dedicate proper development time to that, because it would be, instead of doing the Z80 programming, not as well as, because I just don't have any more time. So that's the sprite editor. Now, how does the tile code work? Well, I've created new tile code, which is specific to the TIE, and it's called Simple Tile Chibi, because chibi means mini. Now, how does it work? Well, it's almost the same as the Spectrum code, obviously without the color information. There's just a few extra additions. Firstly, the tiles are 4 pixels tall now, so we do that. Secondly, it's relying on 2 tile numbers being given to it, one for the left in IXH and one for the right in IXL. It then loads in the memory positions of the 2 tile bitmap data. It stores the second one in IX, the first one is stored in DE as usual. I think it's DE, yes, there it is, DE. And then for each of them, it reads in the left-hand side one, it keeps the leftmost 4 bytes, and then it reads in the right-hand side one, keeps the leftmost 4 bytes, shifts them to the right, merges in the other bytes, and then draws it to the screen. And this obviously is drawing in pairs now, and so I've created a wrapping routine, if I can just find it. So now I've got this routine called render tile, which is what I call at all times to do my drawing now. You can see the this is the regular version. So we've got this, the start drawing and stop drawing, which were noticeable in their absence yesterday because there was a bug. Then it just does the show tile. But the version here is a bit more complicated, not much, but a little bit. And what it does is it removes the last bit. And the reason for that is we're always going to draw a pair, whatever bit, whatever we were actually asked to draw. So we find the first tile, store it in IXH, move along one, because we're going to then draw the one to the right, load it in and store it in IXL, and then we just do show tile. And so this render tile routine is used whenever we need to draw something onto the screen. So here's the fill command. This will fill an area of the screen, and I don't know if you noticed, but we're filling the screen in four sections to speed it up. It gives a kind of a dithering interlace effect, and it's just because it means that the screen is kind of a quarter filled four times faster, if that makes sense. So if we have a look at this do fill command here, you can see I'm moving in pairs, and I'm doing the draw four times on all systems except for the tie, and that's because the tie is always drawing in pairs anyway. So two of the drawing routines would be superfluous. So that's why I'm doing that. Now the reading controls was all done yesterday. The show hex. What I'm doing is I'm reading in the controls here with my standard routine. H and L are the joystick and the keyboard. I and them together so that if either one is pressed, the result is applied. Storing it in H, then I load the current player position in from these variables here. I reset the playing SFX, because if playing SFX is set to zero, then Chibi Sound just turns the sound off. Now I go through here reading. I've got these definitions: key map D, L, R, and U, and F1, F2, which are the bits within H which apply to that joystick button. And then all I do is I check if one is pressed. If it's not, I skip the next bit. If it is, then I check the cursor position, see if we can move the player. If we can, we do. If we can't, then we don't. And then we get down to here. If the player's pressed fire button 2, we clear the screen. If the player's pressed fire button 1, then we set the sound to number 1. Which is a very high-pitched sound. At the bottom here, we read in the sound and play it, and we draw the new sprite at the new tile location by using this find tile, which gets the memory location of the tile map. The tile map on all systems is currently the same. You can see here, 768 bytes, which is 32 times 24. I've got a second tile map because I'm going to have it buffer, because the game logic needs the mold to grow. It will need to compare the old state and draw the new state. So I've kind of got a buffer thing going on here. But as I say, so there's the two tile maps there. There's the player definitions here, and I've got an X2 and a Y2, which will be used later to delete the old position of the player, because obviously this trailing thing is just a nonsense. So that's, as I say, it's all just not finished yet, and that's why that is there. And then I think the only other thing I've really done today is the colour information. So I was loading in a palette before, but I've now got some definitions up the top here. You'll see I've got a definition of palette Gameboy, palette 4 colour, and then palette 16 colour. And if we have a look at, if we just find that, you can see here's the definitions here. So you can see, even though the four color palette is actually defined as 16 palette definitions for now, it doesn't need to be, but I've just left it in for consistency. So if on the 16 color systems, that's what's used. On the four color systems, this is what's used. And then on the Game Boy, this is what's used. Now the Game Boy, the black and white Game Boy, won't use this palette. It just uses a generic black to white grayscale palette. But this is effectively the Game Boy Color palette. Now the Game Boy Color actually works in batches of four colors. It's a palletized system, just like kind of like the Spectrum and the MSX1, really. So this is the default one. This is the second one. This is the third. This is the fourth. And I think you can go up to, I think it's 8 palettes it can have in total, for a total of 56 colors or 64 colors or something like that. It's very, very capable, really. Very nice options they give you on the Game Boy. So, and then each sprite has a colour definition like it did on the Spectrum. If I can find that. So these are the Spectrum definitions, one per sprite. These are the MSX1 definitions, one line per sprite. And these are the new Game Boy colour definitions. So I've defined this sprite here, which is that weird green blob, and palette definition 1 is all greens. So that's how I've done that. Very simple there. And I'll just show you, just in case you're curious. We're going to cover this in more detail in my two programming tutorials later, but if you look at the simple tile command now, you'll see there's a new bit just for the Game Boy Color, and here as well. So this bit isn't really needed, but doesn't do any harm on the black and white Game Boy. What I'm doing here is I'm reading in the palette definitions, finding the correct palette definition for the current sprite, and then storing that palette definition into D. And then when it comes to applying it, what you have to do on the Game Boy Color, and this does only work on the Game Boy Color, you have to send a command to this port here, which says turn on the Game Boy Color special memory bank. The special memory bank stores the extra color information. We then store that D palette selection into the same memory location, but actually now it's within the second memory bank, and then we turn the bank off again and everything's back to normal, and that will do the job of actually setting the color of the tile that we were drawing. And that's all there is to it, really. It's very simple. So there we go. What am I going to do tomorrow? Well, I think I need to look at that MSX bug firstly. I don't know why those sprites were drawing strange. Obviously, I'm going to move on to having proper player control. I will try and get the directions working. Maybe we can get some mold growing tomorrow. That's be a nice thing. Really, it's just generally progressing the game on as much as I can, getting the game mechanics working. I need to draw some more sprites as well, because the objects that will drop the mold spores, I haven't drawn yet. But generally speaking, I think everything's going pretty well. I can't see any major problems at this stage. The only problem I've come across that was a bit of a surprise was on the MSX and MSX2, that it's so slow. I knew it wouldn't be fast, but I didn't realise. I thought the TIE 83 would be the one that would struggle, because if it's you have to do a lot of halts on the TIE 83 display. But actually, it seems to be very, very fast because it's so small. So I'm going to read over the MSX 1 and 2 documentation. There are some other options that I can do, but I just want to try and get myself as clued up as possible, because the better I understand the systems, the less time I waste doing the coding, because as I say, this project has to be finished in 7 days. So it's day 3 tomorrow, still got plenty of time, but you know, don't want to get complacent and waste 4 days doing graphic work on the MSX 1. So anyway, thanks for watching today. Please follow the channel, because obviously I'll be doing a lot more work on these videos. The next video for Patreon backers will be tomorrow. The next video for non-Patreon backers just watching me on YouTube, that will be in a week. Either way, I hope you'll join me. Thanks for watching and goodbye.